Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, here we are! Here we are! You know where we are? Dare? No, I'm not even gonna try pronouncing it. I'm probably gonna have to pronounce it. I'm just gonna try my very best to pronounce it. I don't speak German. I don't know the German accent. I don't know how it's supposed to be said. But what I do know is it's pronounced something on the lines of Der Eisendrach. I don't know. I was told it's pronounced like something like Der Eisendrach or something of that nature, where it makes like a chuch at sound at the end of it. I'm totally wrong. To all my German viewers, I'm so sorry. I don't know how to German. I don't know. But regardless, it's this map. It's the Iron Dragon. It's basically the Iron Dragon. And this is Fireside Bricky. For those of you who have never watched Fireside Bricky, there are only one... Actually, there's two rules. The rule number one is... Go get food. What else is it? Go get some food. You have to watch... Or, no, sorry, not watch. But you have to eat food while watching Fireside Bricky. That is a must. Food, a beverage, anything of that nature must be grabbed. Unless you, like I mentioned before, I think, I'm not sure if you guys are still fasting for Ramadan. If you are, then I guess you're excluded. But for everyone else, yeah. So rule number two is, don't yell at me if I'm dumb. That's actually a joke. You can do whatever the hell you want. But generally, I don't get very far in these game rounds because I just don't. That's just... an unfortunate problem with me is that I don't do very well when I play the Fireside Bricky. I generally do a lot better because I'm not rambling my ass off the entire time. But regardless, you know, I mean, it's just whatever. How much is 1,000 points? Okay, so here we are in Der Eisendrach Keck Keck Top Keck Der Eisendrop Top Keck. This is a German facility in some mountain range. I don't quite know where it is. But, oh, feel that bass? Whoa, 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 whoa. Basically, we're in some German facility that Richthofen used to chill at, and we have Dr. Gruff, which was the doctor on the moon base, if I recall, in Black Ops 1. So, if you don't know the storyline of this map, we took the giant metal robot from the giant, and we head our way back over here, and the Germans have a second version of Dempsey, the older Dempsey, you know, like the old guy Dempsey? They have him in a, like, a cryostasis, and they're gonna launch him to the moon and do mischievous things with him, I guess. I don't know. That's what they're gonna do. And so we have to basically stop them. Now, Richthofen is, of course, a friend of Dr. Gruff. And so when, I think it's pronounced Gruff, and so obviously doctor's just like, what's going on? What are you guys doing here? What are you doing? I'm confused. And so, oh yeah, I forgot the dragons are up here. And so that's kind of what's going on. And so we need to go and actually rescue my second Dempsey self. And big spoiler alert for this map is that you don't actually rescue him, you kill him. You turn off the cryostasis and he just dies. Dempsey's mild dismay, but Richthofen's got some master scheme plan. Obviously this map is called the Iron Dragon. Don't really know the specific reason. Obviously there's a big dragon up there, but I don't know if that's actually the reason or if it's because of another, like, a certain phrase. I mean, that's a dragon. If you remember from Mob of the Dead, there are these giant, there's those giant wolves to help you get a, a tomahawk. This time around, there's these giant dragons to help you go ahead and get a bow and arrow. And that's pretty neat. So what I'm doing is there's three of these guys, and I'm doing my very best to have the dragon eat as many as he can. It takes a few more than the wolves require. And by doing so, I'm going to hopefully get the bow very early on in this game. Now this game, or Der Eisendrach, or the Iron Dragon, whatever you want to call it, is very similar to Origins in the sense that, one, it's got a very similar style, but also there is a shitload of weapons in this thing. A shitload of special power weapons. Oh, I think we're done. Very nice. Like, there are a ton of power weapons on this map. There are so many. Oh, you hear that? Listen. It's Richtofen. So basically, now if Richtofen was actually on this map, because I was playing with multiple players, you'd hear him talk. But he's talking right now. He's basically saying to Dr. Gruff, like, hey, you know, hey, well, yeah, I'm alive, you know, yay, yay for me. And just, and he's basically trying to elude him from actually stopping, or he's going to try and stop him from firing Dempsey to the moon. But he doesn't know that. So, you know, he's kind of like, you know, just being secretive about, like, oh, yeah, I'm here to help, you know, things are okay. You know, like that scene from Star Wars when they're stormtroopers, and he's like, yeah, everything in the detention center is fine, you know, we're all fine. How are you doing today, you know? Is that kind of shit. Oh my god, the zombie. Is that kind of thing. He's just trying to, you know, be all stealthy and shit. And so, of course, they're on the moon currently. The Dr. Grof and his men are on the moon. We're currently here and trying to stop him from firing me to the moon. This is actually one of the few maps that really started getting, like, kind of deeper into the story. Origins did that, but this map is like specifically, hey, we actually have like a legitimate objective, you know? We have to go kill Second Dempsey, which is really interesting because they never had like a legitimate story direct objective necessarily. I mean, it kind of did in some of the Black Ops 2 maps, but you really, in a sense, didn't. There we go, got that power on. So that's kind of a cool little thing that they did. Like, hey, look at that, you know, now they have an actual objective. Oh, I just gotta grab this. There is just so much to this map. Like, there is an insane amount of stuff to this map. Landing pads and the way the pack-a-punch works and the buildables and the items and the bows. Oh, there's just so much stuff on this map. I'm actually trying to find the second piece to the zombie shield. I don't quite know where it spawns. I think it's somewhere up high. I'm not quite sure which bows I'm going to do this time around. I'm probably going to start with the electric bow and then head to the wolf bow. And then after that, see if I can remember how to do the other bows. Because the fire and void bows are kind of a pain in the ass to do sometimes. Actually, not even kind of a pain in the ass. They are a pain in the ass to do. Alright. I'm not quite sure where this thing is. It's somewhere around. Oh, there it is. Anyway. So, anyhow, this is basically what I'm trying to do now, is I'm getting everything as quickly as I possibly can while Richtofen and Dr. Grof are, like, talking to each other, like, hey, you know, we're cool, right? Yeah, yeah, I know we are. And that's really what Der Eisen, whatever the hell it's called, is about. This is actually probably, like, top three, top five favorite maps for me. It was a very impressive map. Hopefully it's a little bit brighter for you guys. I know that the Giant and Shadows of Evil are very dimly lit maps. And I'm probably going to try and up the brightness for you guys from now on, because I heard some complaints saying that the maps were just a bit too dark on the screen. What the hell? That was ridiculous. That was ridiculous. That should not have happened. Okay, well, it's like I'm going to have to go get myself a revive soda again. Jesus. Oh, shit. God, these zombies run fast. I remember these zombies ever running this fast. I remember I have to go run back and get revive soda again. But anyway, this is definitely one of my favorite maps. I think considered by the community is one of the best maps. It's also one of the easier maps because with the bows you get in this maps, it's just like so much easier to do so many things. But you can just survive to a very, very high round with this entire map because of just the power you get automatically. Like, you just get so much stuff so quickly. And so many weapons at your disposal. Running out of ammo is very rare. The bows are broken. They're not as broken as the staffs, but they're... Okay, one of them is, I think, maybe more broken than the staffs. But they're really broken, dude. They're just really broken. Okay, I don't really know how I'm going to do this. I want to get down here. I don't know how much this costs, though. Oh, wait, it's already open. Oh, shit, Juggernaut's already open. Oh, shit. Oh, neat. Gotta survive with the Pharaoh for a bit. There we go. Look at all this pyramid, the keepers, stuff like that. This place actually goes low gravity every so often. Anyway, Oh, yeah, I should probably start that, by the way. You have to turn them on. But one of the interesting things about this map is the fact that... the Easter egg is not the hardest Easter egg in the world, but it's definitely not an easy Easter egg. I wouldn't call it easy at all. And the thing about this Easter egg, though, is that at the end of the Easter egg, I'm sorry, if these are spoilers, then I apologize, but it's just, I don't know how many of you are going to be playing this for the Easter egg anyway, if you haven't already done it. But the greatest thing is that the Easter egg in this map, at the end, there's actually a boss battle. Like, a legit, full-on, straight-up boss battle with, like, mechanics. Like, Destiny, like, you know, FPS or MOBAs or whatever, or not MOBAs, I'm sorry, MMO, like, boss battle mechanics. You have to do these things at this certain time to kill the boss. Like, I mean, it's not the greatest boss battle, and it's far from it, actually, but the fact that they put a boss battle at the end of an Easter egg in a zombies map is kind of, it's a little bit impressive that they went that far, you know? It's like, oh, I just did not expect that. I did not expect them to add a boss battle at the end of the, oh, I did not mean to kill two of them. At the end of an Easter egg. It's so foreign for a Call of Duty game. Like, especially, I mean, Black Ops 3 has kind of gone past some of those weird barriers before. Like, they've had boss battles in the campaign, a couple of them, actually. And they had them to the Nazi zombies. I mean, it's definitely not a bad thing. I think it's actually really cool. It's just, you know, unexpected. Just definitely not something that I expected to see. Especially, it's Call of Duty, you know, it's known as the generic shooter. Having a boss battle is pretty cool. So, anyhow, I'm feeding this dragon still, as you can probably tell. Are you done, dragon? Nope, still need more? Okay. I don't know how many more I'm going to need, but I want to hopefully get a headshot on this last zombie so I can pick up Juggernog. I'm going to be running low on ammo soon, though. Oh, sweet. Got it. Going to stand on this real quick. There we go. So now this room is in zero gravity. Very neat little thing. It allows you to do, like, the wall running that the Black Ops 3 has, but, you know, actually give you a reason to do it. Oh, sweet. And a max ammo. Perfect. This is what I need him. I need to find the last piece of the zombie shield, though. It's up here somewhere. Just don't know where specific. Oh, there it is. Whoa. Got it. Hey. Zombo dogs. The only major downside of this map is it has the Panzer Soldat, which is that big metal dude in Origins. Never was a huge fan of having to deal with that guy. So, yeah. Anyhow, enough about the zombie map. I'm sorry, I talked a lot about the zombies map today because I just very much enjoy this map. I think it's a ton of fun. But, anyhow. Oh, yeah. There's a... He's getting upset with Richtofen now, but anyhow. So, what I was going to discuss today. There was a lot of things I was thinking about discussing. I didn't quite know what I wanted to talk about. And there's always a lot of different topics when it comes down to Fireside Bricky, but I kind of wanted this topic to be a little bit more, I don't know if you want to say a little more casual. I wanted just to talk about games and, you know, just gaming, and maybe not super casual, but also just like some hobbies and things like that. And I'm not going to talk about huge like life lessons or anything like that, or, well, my life lessons, you know, everyone has their own life lessons, but I just want to discuss, like, actually have like a more of a genuine, relaxing discussion than an actual like crazy go deep type thing, you know, because that's just, you know, that eventually gets tiresome, I would say. One of the things I actually was kind of wanting to talk about was something. It's an Overwatch thing, because I talked a little bit about Overwatch when it came down to the last Fireside Bricky, but I want to discuss something that I kind of enjoy about the game that I don't think people really discuss too often, and that's skill ceiling. Now, skill ceiling is something that, if you guys don't know what it means, it's two things. There's learning curve and skill ceiling. A learning curve is how much time it takes for you to learn a character or a gun or something like that in a game, you know? Like, if a gun is, like, really powerful but has a lot of recoil, it's how you learn to control it, you know, things like that. Or maybe a character that's really hard to play. There we go, final one's down. A good example of this would be, say, Azir from League of Legends. It requires a lot of skill to learn how to play this character. Or perhaps, maybe, I don't know, how about the, maybe a CZ-75 from, CSGO. Like, a CZ-75 from CSGO, like, it's a very interesting weapon. It's not necessarily a very easy weapon to use, at least not in my opinion. Oh, the guy's very angry at Richtofen right now. What was I going to do next? Oh yeah, Weather Vane. And so this idea of learning curve, but skill curve is basically, it's like how you say, the more you play the character, the better you become at the character. Now this is something that's kind of interesting. It's, I mean, Azir from League of Legends would be a good decision, thought about that as well. But also, things like, no, let's say the AWP from CSGO. You know, a guy who's an AWPer who uses the AWP all the time is someone who you gotta be like, okay, gotta be scared of this guy. He's a really good AWP player. Or somebody perhaps like, or it's say if you go back to something like League of Legends, you can go with a, or even Azir is a good example of this as well. You know, he plays a lot of that character. You're just like, okay, very scared, quite scary. As opposed to someone who's very easy, like, oh, I don't know, maybe Garen, who is not, like, his skill curve isn't as high. You can't do as much crazy shit with him. Go, go, go. This is the idea of a skill ceiling. Now, in Overwatch, there's a lot of different characters, a lot of different stuff. Now, a lot of people joke about, oh, what's that one guy? Soldier 76, being the easy guy. You know, he's the easy character. He's just 76, he's that COD character. When in reality, or sorry, let me rephrase that. When somebody like, say, Genji or Zenyatta or Hanzo are the high skill ceiling, you play a lot of those characters, they're gonna fuck you up, and they're hard to play. Now, originally, I could understand this idea, but after playing the game, I realized that skill ceiling is pretty high on almost every character. Because here's the thing, right? When you play, let's say, a MOBA game, in a MOBA, when you play a MOBA, you basically have to... Wait, where am I going? I'm going this way. You know, when in order to hurt somebody, like with a basic attack, you have to right-click on them. You right-click, you start attacking them. Simple as that. That's where it ends. That's where it ends for the mechanics of just a basic attack. When it comes to, say, an FPS, you can't just press and hold. You have to aim. And in a game with the hybrid genre-like of Overwatch that contains both FPS and kind of MOBA elements, like class-based, I mean, I say MOBA because, you know, you got like two abilities, they have cooldowns, it's very MOBA-like. When you have that kind of dynamic to it, it really makes you realize that, okay, not only is it, I have to work about cooldown management and team fighting and things like that, I also have to worry about how you say, oh, fuck, what's it called? Oh, you also have to worry about aiming and aiming correctly. Twisted goals. Oh, shut up, you. What a negative Nancy. Never leave the castle alive. Okay. Gonna go ahead and hit this guy up here. Too low. Nailed it. Okay. Anyhow, as I was saying, I realized that there's actually a pretty high skill ceiling with almost every character. Because every character needs to aim. And if you can't aim, you can't hit. And if you can't hit, you lose a lot. You know, like even a character as simple as Soldier, you know, how good are you at, like, if a Soldier doesn't land headshots, he only lands body shots, it doesn't do very much damage. A Soldier that lands like all headshots that has an aim of like a legend that always lands headshots and does a really good job at that, that it can like direct shot his Helix rockets, that can use a biotic field to actually heal his own teammates. That's a nice skill ceiling. You know, that's one thing that I've actually kind of, I think competitive COD esports isn't necessarily given enough credit on, is that, you know, it's not easy to aim some of these things. You know, it's hard to aim, especially in a game like Black Ops 3 that has such a high movement, such a huge movement emphasis. It's not easy to just like auto, you can't just auto right click, you know, you have to like really get your aim and recoil management down. Same thing with CSGO, it's just difference with CSGO and COD is that with COD, you're just like, you're moving around at Mach 5, you're just going and going and going. Oh shit. Okay, I gotta get this done quickly. Oh shit. Oh dear. Oh dear! Oh my god. Oh my god, I don't think you guys realize how close that was. I bet even the That was terrifying. That was straight, unadulterated, terrifying. Holy shit. Holy shit, that was close. I feel they have all these different kinds of zombies over here. Come on. There we go. Ow. Alright, come on, let me out of here. Let me out of here, come on. Actually? Let me go pack a punch my VMP. But anyway, as I said... Sorry, I had to unclench my butthole from that fight. From getting in there. That was no bueno. That was terrifying. So anyhow, I really like the fact that they have this high skill ceiling with these characters, because there are some that I think have higher than others. Like, I feel like Hanzo and Zenyatta are great examples of characters that just are simply better. But have a simply higher skill ceiling, harder to use just in general, and it pays you off more when you're good at them. But I realize that every character actually has a decent skill ceiling. That maybe some characters are easier to play, but they can all be extremely effective. And I like that. I like that dynamic. Wow, that's lag. Wow, that was lag. That was a lot of lag. Whoa, that was scary to me for a second. Oh, wrong way. So, yeah, no, I'm just kind of like, I like that. I like that mechanic. I like the fact that there's a really nice skill ceiling, because for me, like, before, if you said, I'm a really good soldier player, people are like, what? I was like, I'm a really good soldier player. Like, that was a term that people would, like, laugh at, like, a really good soldier player. Uh-huh. Hey, I think I can feel it working already. Because, like, why would a... Nice, I hit that shit. Oh, that feels good. Like, you know, why would anyone say that? It's such a silly sailing. A really good soldier player, you know? But in reality, yeah, you are. There is such a thing. You know, a really good soldier player is scary. Because he lands headshots upon headshots upon headshots. And you're like, fuck, dude. I keep getting just demolished by this soldier guy. You know, skill ceiling is something I've always kind of gravitated towards, characters that require a very high skill ceiling to play. Because it's something I've always enjoyed. You know, I've always enjoyed, you know, trying really hard to... You know, play the hard character and show off my skills. You know, I've always liked that. It's just kind of thing I've really enjoyed. You know, it's fun. It's fun to do that kind of thing. Oh, thank God for max ammo. And so that's why. I mean, unfortunately though, I don't play the very hard characters in Overwatch. I play like Soldier and Roadhog, and I don't play like Genji or Zenyatta or Hanzo. I play a little bit of Hanzo, but very little Soldier or Zenyatta. Or sorry, Genji or Zenyatta. Okay. Here we go, me. You can do this, me. Got the one. Got the two. Got the three. Oh, that was close. Come on. Oh. No! Dicks! Two. You have to run on the wall and hit all these things. Three. There's not one over there, is there? There is one over there. Shit. Got it. Ho-ho. That was closer than I would have liked. By a decent margin. I was not feeling that. That was terrifying. Alright. We're okay, though. We're okay. Who's gonna buy next? Stamina up is what I'm gonna buy next. I want the extra movement speed, considering how much I run around. But... Anyhow, it's something that I've just really enjoyed in games like that. It's a fun idea. It's nice to feel like, you know, because then you just be called like a puss for like using an easy character, quote unquote. But really in Overwatch, there are easier to play characters, but man, you can pull off some good shit. Like, I already made my Monday vlog because I'm going to Anime Expo this weekend. And when I made the Monday vlog, I decided to, made the Monday vlog, which you'll probably watch in 2 days because I'm probably going to upload this on Saturday. I went a soldier in an entire Overwatch game, was on fire for 84% of the match. It was ridiculous. I was pretty on point. I felt good about my gameplay right there. I think next to the urns, right? Yep, the urns. You know, I felt super good about that. And so that's what I was pleased about. So, anyhow, as I was saying before, is that, Oh, yeah, so I like that skill ceiling. So like I said, I'm getting distracted because this is you know, it's Nazi zombies. It's Fireside Bricky. If I'm not rambling and getting confused, I'm not doing it right. I might get myself killed here. I just need to be careful. Okay, I finished this one up. Whew, that was close. Alright. I just gotta do the other couple errands as well. Oh wait, I gotta have to hit the death ray. Zip, 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 zip. It's a cool little zappy ray. It's neat. They just see like that. Zip. But, you know, there's also things like, even in games like Call of Duty, where, especially in zombies, like knowing what to do, knowing how to manipulate zombie AI, like that, even that has a decently high skill ceiling. Even though it may not seem like it, it does. Just how that works. Oh, so that's where that went. Cool beans. Okay, go grab that one. Get in here first and do... This is the hardest one right here, is being able to get the lightning urn shot right over here. Pretty difficult. Oh, I need double tap. I should have bought double tap instead of stamina up. Stamina up is great, but I probably should have just bought double tap. I have a couple good perk or gobble gums today that I could go ahead and use. Okay, sweet. Done with this area. Whee! What's the last one? I have to kill a panda, sold that for the last one. That's right. So that's two of the urns. Last one is at the rocket launch site, if I recall. I can jump down there after I buy Juggernog. Anyhow. So that's just something I just wanted to like talk about a little bit. It's one thing that I very, very much enjoy about the game is the skill ceiling for some of the characters. Just if you're good at that kind of game, if you're good at FPS and you can aim, because a lot of people are coming there from MOBAs and they can't aim at all. Like, a lot of them are coming there from MOBA games like League of Legends, and they're just like, they don't play FPS games, and they can't aim, and they miss so many of their shots. Like, you could be great at a game, but you can't land your shots in an FPS. You don't win. You don't win at all. Your team comp can be the greatest team comp ever. You could have the best offense, defense thing ever, but you're not going to go anywhere if you don't have, if you can't aim at all, if you can't hit people. Sweet, got it. Weeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeee the urn. I just gotta be careful and zap some guys around this urn. Woo! This is always been a little bit frightening for me, this area. Okay, can I crawler one? Can I crawler one? Yes, I can. And I got a crawler. I can go ahead and use this for... Oh, unless the thing burns. Oh, that may be a problem. Alright, we'll try this again. Next step is I have to light these these bows with electricity and then fire them at there. Nailed it! Oh, first try, that feels good. Boop. Hey, double points. I kind of want to get ammo for this. I kind of don't, so I'm just going to leave it and hopefully get a max ammo because I do have my Wrath of the Ancients. Boink. All right, so where's the next urn? That was the first urn. Where's the... Oh, right, I have to go from the one upstairs, I think. Yeah. And then use that urn. All right, they have some weird spots with these urns. So this is the cool thing about this map, like I said, is it's like practically Easter egg in an Easter egg. Gotta get all the bows, which are practically Easter eggs, and then use those bows to activate the real Easter egg. It's a long map full of lots of running around and lots of crazy stuff. Okay, let's go ahead and grab this guy right here. Thank you very much. And where's the urn? There's the urn. Oh, hi. What's up, buddy? Did I miss, really? Who knew? Fuck. Okay. Just borrow that. Thank you. I can't believe I missed that shot. Got it. Last one is the hardest one. By far is the hardest one. I'm a little bit scared trying to go get this one, so I'm going to need the Anywhere But Here gobble gum to keep me alive for when I fire my shots. Because this is a problem. Yep, I missed. I can't see anything, though. I hit it! No way, I actually hit it! Oh my god. I'm sorry if I clip my mic or something like that, but... Oh my god, I can't believe I actually hit that! No way. That, oh my, you have no idea how great this feels right now. I wish I could explain to you how amazing that is, the fact that I actually hit that one. If you guys don't, if you guys play zombies, you probably understand. But if you don't, then you just, you can't understand the excitement that just occurred in my body when I hit that shot. God damn, that was cool. I need new gobblegum. Do they have gobblegum down here? They do have gobblegum down here. Oh, sweet. That was really close. That was exceptionally close. I think I have that, though. Thank you. Gobblegum are a little bit broken sometimes, but this was a time when it was actually okay. All right. So where am I going to go? Oh, yeah, I got to go up back to the weather vane. Whew. Sorry, I'm trying to think of other topics to discuss right now because I just decided to do a free flow. But at the same time, like, I really want to get this done. Did I just shoot that again? I have to press X. I think I just press X. Yep. So, anyhow, I was saying, okay, so other things I was talking about. Well, I want to talk a little bit about Anime Expo and just kind of discussions about Anime Expo. Because I am going to Anime Expo this weekend, as I'm sure some of you may have seen. I uploaded a little video saying I'm going to Anime Expo just as kind of like a, you know, little thing. Because that's just what I'm doing, because that's a good idea, just so people know. Thank you. And so when I'm going to Anime Expo, I thought, like, it's weird because it's the first time I'm actually going to be going to a major, massive convention besides San Diego Comic-Con while being bricky. Because I went to Summoner's Con, I got a couple people that noticed me at Summoner's Con, but only a couple. And it was fun and all, but it wasn't like a massive convention, you know, like a big convention. It wasn't anything like that. It was the big convention, but it wasn't like, you know, it's not Anime Expo. You're actually getting max ammo every time you do that. I need to remember that. I could just use this. And so I'm excited, but I'm also kind of a little bit nervous. I don't know why. I mean, I've gone to a big convention before. I mean, San Diego Comic-Con is probably the biggest convention I could think of. It's 250,000 people, and it's so damn difficult to get into, and people still, like, chill around the outside as well. But with Comic-Con, or with Anime Expo, it's the first time ever going to a major convention as Bricky, you know? Before, I just went as Taylor, you know? Taylor, the regular old me, chilling around. I was the one excited to meet my idols, you know? And there are a lot of people there that I really want to meet. Like, it's funny, it's weird, because being a YouTuber, it's hard for me to contain my excitement for being certain YouTubers, because then it sounds like I'm, like, trying to leech off them, or I'm, you know, I'm, I mean, it's, like, hard not to fanboy over certain YouTubers. That's difficult. That's difficult not fanboying over certain YouTubers or cosplayers that I really want to see. Like, there are some cosplayers that I really want to see that I'm quite excited to see, but it'd be weird, like, talking to them on Twitter and getting all like, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, it's you, oh my god, you're my biggest idol, oh my god, you know. I don't want to be like that, because that's weird, but at the same time, like, I'm excited. Here's the first bow. Want to see this shit? If you guys have epilepsy, I'm very, very sorry. You fire this giant tornado that basically just goes around zapping things. Forever. Not forever, but for a very long time. It's a little bit broken. And by a little bit broken, I mean it's pretty fucking broken, dude. Like, it's really broken. What's this? Oh, wall power. Oh, is there any good wall weapons on this map? Maybe I should go get the KRM. You can get a lot of good stuff off that. Maybe I will get the KRM. There's a couple good wall weapons on this map. I don't know what has good ammo, though. But the M8. The M8's got good ammo, right? I might just do the KRM. I like shotguns. Lots of damage because of the... Yeah, you know what? I'll do that. Dagon's... Or it's Dagon's Glare. That's so much fun. That's a lot of damage, too. But, like, you know, that's actually one of the bigger things that I always had a trouble with discussing as well. Is, like, cosplaying. Like, because I was going to get my Elder Max in cosplay. If you guys don't know, I'm actually cosplaying as Elder Max. And my beard wouldn't normally be this long. But Maxon's beard is a lot longer. So, or a lot longer than my normal beard. So that's why I was growing it out for a while. And, it's too bad because I really wanted to cosplay as Maxon for Anime Expo, but I realized I'm not going to be able to. There's no way I'm going to have time for that, to finish it up in time, but it was close. By the way, I'm gonna go do the wolf bow now, so I'm putting it back, at least for the first part. And so because of, you know, because of that, I'm trying to the cosplay and things like that. I'm gonna be going with myself, and I'm going to be probably meeting a lot of other cosplayers. I'm trying my best to figure out how to say a cosplayer looks really good without sounding thirsty as fuck. Okay, that's not the first painting. You have to go around doing paintings now for the wolf bow. But it's really difficult to go tell a cosplayer they look really good, especially in Anime Expo, without sounding ridiculously thirsty, you know? I think you guys can sympathize with me on this one, right? Because, like, I'm gonna, you know, there's gonna be certain cosplayers there, like, a lot of cosplayers that I really like, I know, like, five off the top of my head, that I really want to see, and that, you know, when they're going there, it's gonna be... Damn it. It's going to be, very, like, it's gonna be weird, because they're probably gonna be wearing, you know, a rather, most likely a rather lewd cosplay, because that's generally what people do, and it's gonna be weird going in and saying, hey, that looks really good, you look very, very, like, pretty in that, without sounding, like, super, like, hi, you know, without going all awkward moments, bricky. I'm sure I'm exaggerating. I'm sure it'll be fine. And maybe I'll be able to get a little bit of a... maybe I'll be able to, like, pull off some kind of... Just maybe I'll put them in the vlog, and so therefore it'll seem less weird, because I'm like, oh, no, I'm just vlogging, and I'll say hi. Because there's lots of cosplayers that look really good, and it's difficult to figure out how to tell them that they look really good without sounding weird. Which is unfortunate, because that's something I've always really tried to be an advocate for, was telling somebody they look good, just honestly, you know? Yes, I got the paintings in the correct order, thank God. Because that's the thing, is that I have a real, not a real difficulty, but people have a real difficulty expressing their liking for a certain person's cosplay or a certain person in general without sounding really weird or cringy. Because everyone thinks if you compliment another girl, regardless, you're like, you're trying to hit on them. When in reality, you're just trying to say, like, hey, that looks really good, you know? And that's a big problem that I think we have nowadays, is guys can't seem to say that without people being like, telling them they're being awkward or something. Oh, come on. Oh, shit. Did I hit it or not? God damn it. I fucked that up bad. We don't gotta tell the others about this, right? I had a feeling that might happen, but I was being a little bit too careless with my life right there. But, you know, there's gonna be like, cause you think about what's gonna be there, what kind of anime, or not anime, but cosplayers are gonna be there, and you gotta think, okay, there's gonna be probably a lot of Overwatch. I'm sure there's gonna be plenty of Widowmakers. Widowmakers, you know? Yeah. It's probably gonna be a lot of Tracers, some Mercies maybe, some Divas, lots of Divas probably, and they all wear skin-tight bodysuits. How can I compliment these people without sounding just really weird? You know, that's the big challenge, because, I mean, some guys just go for it, and you know, but they go for it while being weird, and it's just like, well, shit, I don't want to be like that. It's a difficult line you gotta ride. It's a difficult line you gotta ride, and especially some people that, like, go and compliment and they just, like, they follow them. That's weird. Don't do that. Don't follow people. That's weird. You know, they're just, like, you know, they talk to them like really big fans and they follow them around the convention. Like, no. Let them be. Don't be that guy. Where's the, I put it way over in the other direction. I gotta go get that back. Honestly, probably just gonna tell them, like, hey, that looks really good. You look really good. Have a good day. That's probably going to be the end of it. That, okay, but we're going back to deep topics. This is something that I've always tried to advocate, especially when it comes to real life, is if somebody looks really good, just tell them. And for a convention, it's a little bit more difficult because they're, especially an anime convention, because there are certain people there that are not necessarily, oh, right, I was supposed to do that first. Oh, that's awkward. But, you know, they're gonna be talked with a lot of very strange people, and yeah, they're gonna be weirded out because there's gonna be some very strange people at anime. It's Anime Expo. It's just people are odd. Why was I down here again? Down here for another reason. I don't know what I was down here for. Oh right, zombie shield. But you gotta ride that line. You know, you gotta be careful. You gotta ride that line. And you gotta run the line between creepy and actually sincere. So, but in real life, especially in like a non-con setting, so long as you're not hitting on somebody, like, unless you, I mean, you want to hit on them, it's fine, you know, do whatever the hell you want, I don't give a shit. But specifically things like restaurants, something like that, you know, or just like a retail worker, you know. I worked at Dairy Queen for a long, long time. And when, at the end of the day, when you're just tired as shit, when just life has just not treated you well, you had like a million just dumbass customers. Having some person go up and like compliment you on something, it just means the world, dude. It just means the world. It really does. I gotta be really careful here. I don't think I need any more ammo with this, so I'm good now. Oh dear. I'm running out of ammo. Did I pick it up? Sweet, good. Alright, I'm gonna have to go buy something now. I gotta go get the other bow. But... ah, oh, fuck. Come on. Going this way instead. So, yeah, you know, like, I went to a couple of times, you know, you go to, like, I think it was the Rocky Mountain Chocolate Factory in the Irvine Spectrum. They had this one girl that was working there that was super nice, you know, very, very friendly. And she had this necklace. She had this, like, really pretty golden necklace. And I don't know what it was from or who it was from, but when I was checking out, I was like, hey, you know, that necklace is, like, really pretty. That looks really good. Where'd you get it? And then she said it was, like, a present or something like that from her parents, whatever it was. And I was like, yeah, you know, that looks really damn good. And then, no, she was, like, she seemed decently happy. She also seemed kind of, like, hesitant. Like, is this guy hitting on me? Is he being weird? But then I got my food or my chocolate and I left. And then you could tell and visibly, like, on their face, like, oh, well, that was nice. Because it's not, you don't have to, like, hit on, like, once they realize that you're not actually hitting on them and they're actually, you're just being, like, a genuinely nice person, it makes a whole world of difference, dude. It makes a whole world of difference. And I think it's a really important thing that people are starting to forget. They're always too worried about thinking that someone's going to be hitting on them, or they're thinking that they're hitting on somebody, or that something like that, they're going to be weirded out. And they're worried about, like, rejection or whatever it might be. And so they won't do anything like that. And it's disappointing because there really needs to be more people that compliment other people like that. I mean, this works a bit better for on a guy thing because not super often, unless there's, like, a really cool thing that they both like, will a guy seem to compliment a girl a girl compliment a guy super often. Now, of course, I am speaking, I'm generalizing an exceptional amount, but normally, I see more guys compliment girls than vice versa. Unless, of course, like, you know, you've got, like, a really cool tattoo that they both really like, or maybe, perhaps, you have, like, a shirt, like, that you're both wearing Star Wars shirts, and you're like, hey, like, we're friends now. That kind of shit. That shit's different. But, I know, like, that small stuff goes such a long way, dude. It goes such a long way. So few people really think about, like, just the small compliment goes so far, dude. It goes so far. And too few people do it. I just got a perkaholic. Well, that just happened. If you guys don't know, a perkaholic gives you every perk in the game. I really hope I don't get down now. I would be very upset if I got down now. But anyhow, as I was saying before, now for a convention, it's a little bit different, only because the people at the convention have been known to be kind of strange. You know, I mean, this is, of course, not for everybody, but a lot of times, you know, we all hear about the horror stories that cosplayers and YouTubers can have at conventions where X person was being really weird and followed them around for a long time, or X person said some weird sexual things to a cosplayer. And, you know, there's of course a line that happens to need to be drawn, especially at a place like a Comic-Con, because that's just the biggest offense. That's where all that comes from the most. You see that shit there the most out of anywhere else. And, you know, I mean, hey, that's just what happens, you know? Not, I mean, that's why you just gotta be careful with, you know, how you say it and stuff like that at a convention. Especially considering that, let's be honest, Video games have a lot of characters that are very lewd. Lewd characters are cosplayed quite often. Combine the two of these things together, you have a lot of very, very attractive lewd cosplayers, and that can equal a lot of very odd, awkward situations. So, you gotta be careful with that kind of stuff. For me, I'm probably just gonna be like, hey, that looks awesome. You look awesome. Keep going. And then make it something simple like that, because I have a little bit less shame than normal. Because I'm just that way. Because, you know, I do YouTube. It's I'm not like Mr. Weird Guy anymore. It's not gonna be considered Mr. Weird Guy anymore. I'm this guy. And when you're this guy, you're like, oh, you know, you already may know who I am. And it's, you know, it's not gonna be as awkward. Because, you like, it's kind of like a stranger thing. But more of like a trust thing. Because, I mean, of course there are some bad apples. But generally, like, there's everyone knows, you know, stranger danger. But when you have a YouTuber who does this thing for for life and just has so many different things that he does, whether it be, you know, gaming or lifestyle vlogging, you see this person in their life all the time. So the, oh god, this person may be weird and a murderer is less common, because it's just, the possibility of it happening is far less, because they're just, their entire life is out there for people to see, mainly. There are, of course, exceptions of people that end up being weird and problematic, but overall, there's a lot more of a trust factor, because they have a spotlight on them for a long time. I could have made that Ragnarok DG4 so much earlier, but I simply didn't. Nah, I really like this gun. Oh, I thought it was fully automatic for a second. Just pressed and held and thought it was gonna go even more. All right, time for the next one. The wolf bow. I gotta climb all the way up here. Whee! There we go. Get them bones. Thank you very much. And we're heading back. Yeah, but anyway, as I said, it's something that I think people should do more often. It's honestly just something that people should do more often. Just compliment people. Compliments are fucking awesome, dude. You ever had a compliment? Probably. And you know what happens when people compliment? You feel great. Everyone feels great. Especially when it's like a meaningful, actually coming from the heart, not just trying to get inside your pants kind of compliment. Those are the best. Those are the best shit, you know? You know, I mean, it's really nice when I can find myself a genuine compliment on my YouTube channel, or a genuine compliment just in general, because a lot of times, you know, I'm not trying to brag or anything, but I get a lot of compliments on my channel for videos and stuff like that, but sometimes a lot of them are kind of pandery, you know, or they have like a second goal, you know, they'll make like a nice compliment, they'll be all nice and shit, but then they'll make like, oh yeah, it's all nice and stuff, and also I would really like it if, you know, you did this, and then realize, oh, they're just asking me for something. You know, they didn't actually mean like the really nice compliment, they had like a hidden agenda. And I was like, oh. But I was like actually being normal. And then that happens with lots of YouTubers and lots of people. It's just something that people do. And I mean, it happens everywhere. It happens everywhere you go. People will be really nice and then have a different agenda. And it's too bad. But overall, when I find myself like a really legit, genuine compliment, I'm pretty happy. I'm actually very happy. It's like, oh, cool. I'm happy to hear that. Is it not done yet? I thought it was done by now. How much is left? God damn, there's a lot left. Damn, still not yet? Holy shit. Anyhow. This is like a little discussion thing on that kind of topic. Just, you know, being a chill person, you know, being genuine with your compliments, just, it means so much more when it actually comes from someone who actually means what they're talking about. You're just like, oh, nice. This makes me happy, you know? There is of course a line that might need to be drawn sometimes, depending on what you say specifically, where things can get kind of weird, but yeah, that's just real life in general. Wolf bow is done. Thank you very much. Got the wolf bow. So you guys know the wolf bow is nowhere near as good as electric bow, but damn, does it look cool. You want to see this ship? You want to see how cool this shit looks? Here we go. Here we go. Oh, wait, hold on. I want to get like a nice train of zombies. There it goes. That's so cool. I love that so much. It's such a cool bow. Where's the pack-a-punch? Is that the rocket launch test, I think? You know, I'm actually kind of stuck because I really don't know how to finish the void and fire bow. I've done it before, but it takes a lot of time, and especially the void one that requires like me practically writing. Practically writing down what the guy says, and the fire one being just a real pain in the ass considering what it asked you to do. I'm just like not feeling doing those bows. Like the wolf bow and the electric bow are, I think, a lot easier than the rest of the bows, especially the fire one. The fire one's really tough sometimes. Hopefully, I mean, maybe I'll get it done, but I probably won't. I mean, I'm kind of feeling like just surviving for as long as I can now with the bows I currently have. The Perkaholic is going to make it a little hard to die, but I don't know, maybe I'll try the fire bow or the void bow. I don't know quite yet. I'll have to make that decision in a bit. Come on, pack a punch. There we go. There we go. You know, interesting thing about the end of this Easter egg. If you actually complete the end of this Easter egg, you actually blow up the moon. The moon just blows up. Like, you blew up the Earth on the moon one, and you went back in time, and now you blew up the moon. Dead wire on both? Oh, come on. I don't want dead wire. I forgot, they gave you a couple new skin or camos for these. I like fireworks. I can do fireworks. Ow. Much easier. Much easier. Oh, max ammo already, huh? You know, considering this map is pretty damn easy to play once you get far enough into the map. But at the same time, it's also like, the environment's pretty tough because there's really no good place to train, with the exception of, I'd say the rocket launch site, but the launch site eventually forces you inside the area, which is very claustrophobic, and if you're out of ammo, you're pretty much dead. There's very few ways for you to actually be able to escape that area. Death Machine helps out a lot, though. So, oh, interesting, another different kind of discussion topic. Super Smash Brothers. Now, for a while, I liked Super Smash Brothers, but never really played it a whole lot. Oh no, it's gone. I never really played it a whole lot, because I just didn't play the game a whole lot. But it wasn't like, I didn't like hate it. I thought the community is kind of asshole-y, and then especially the Melee community are kind of dicks sometimes. And I think a lot of people can agree with me on that one, because they tend to be a little bit, how you say, stuck up and extremely salty. You know, Super Smash Brothers Melee, Fox only, no items, final destination every single match is like, Melee is the only good Smash, all other Smash games are inferior. You know, it's a very stuck up kind of community sometimes. And that's the sign that I kind of don't really like to have to deal with. So, because of that, I just don't really play much Melee. I don't really get into the whole Smash Brothers crowd too often. However, I have been playing a little bit of Super Smash Brothers 4. Or I think they call it Smash 4, right? Smash 4 at my buddy's place. And I gotta admit, it's a fun time. I really enjoy it. I'm enjoying it actually a little bit more than Melee, personally. I mean, I like Melee. It's nostalgic. But it's not like my dream best Smash ever game. I don't know, I'm actually liking 4 a lot. And, I mean, maybe because I'm just a casual player and I don't really care about, like, certain characters and frames and things like that. It's just not my thing. But I'm having a good time. And the characters I'm playing the most and I seem to be best at is Bayonetta and Samus. Not Zero Suit Samus, regular Samus. Now, apparently Bayonetta was like too ridiculously levels, crazy, stupidly overpowered for a while. Like she had like a crazy combo. And that's just like, and apparently she got nerfed. Now she's like mid tier, I guess, mid tier level, maybe like mid to high tier level. I don't really know the levels right now. All I know is that Sheik and Zero Suit Samus are apparently very, very strong right now. And so anyway, so I played Bayonetta after the nerf. And I like her. She has a very interesting combo setup thing. Lots of nice little poke maneuvers. I like her kit. I think Witch Time is one of the most unique and interesting abilities there is. I love Witch Time. I think it's very neat. And I don't know, and of course I like Bayonetta character because butts and ass and booty. No, not really. But I do like her character though. Bayonetta 1 was a fantastic game. Didn't play Bayonetta 2 because I don't own a Wii U. That's a rhyme. But no, Bayonetta's a really fun character, and I just like her. It's very neat. You know, Platinum Games makes some very fun stuff. Do I lose this Perkaholic if I eat it? Does this go away forever? I really hope it doesn't go away forever. But anyhow, I like playing her. I also like playing Samus because I feel like Samus just hits really hard. And I didn't know that her screw attack actually has a crit at the end of it. Before, in Melee and Brawl, her screw attack was just for a little bit of like damage, but there was no way to actually knock somebody off the map with it. And that really upset me. Or, you know, like, I think it's something they call it, a knockout or whatever it is, like a critical strike. But what is also nice is that now that it has that, it gives me not only that option, but I also get like a lot of damage out of it. And not only that, but Samus hits fucking hard, dude. Like, she does damage in regular form. And you can like spam missiles and have your charged up, whatever it's called, power thing, whatever you call it. What's it called? Her little arm cannon, the powered up arm cannon ball. And you can, you know, you can fuck with people with your morph bomb, because then you can like bounce in the air for a split second, messing up their attacks. And not only that, but all of her major, I don't know what they're called, not smash moves, but they're like her heavy attacks, we use like the C key or whatever, are just super strong, just extremely powerful attacks. And I very much like that. I like the fact that they all hit so hard and they're very fast. You know, Bayonetta's got some really cool heavy attacks with those, like, the giant fist and things like that. Because, you know, she's Bayonetta. But Samus has some very fun abilities, and it's a lot of fun. I gotta admit, I really do enjoy this this new iteration. I might get into it a little bit more. I probably won't buy a Wii U, because if I can't make videos of it, because they don't let you make videos of Smash, because Nintendo are kind of dicks, unless you have, like, a special kind of agreement with them. I probably won't buy a Wii U because it's just not worth my time, honestly. I don't really want to deal with that. And I know I have a bit of spite against Nintendo because of their you can't put any of our stuff on YouTube thing. I just think it's very annoying. It's a very douchebag thing that companies do. Place you right there. Enjoy yourself. Again, if you have epilepsy, I'm very sorry. I did not mean to do this to you. I can't put these guys up. They just go the entire distance, don't they? Shit, dude. Pick that back up and head back out. So, yeah, I really like it. Characters I hate, though. Okay, Captain Falcon makes me just very angry. I don't know because he's so damn fast or what specifically, but the guy I fight really likes Captain Falcon. And it makes me very angry due to the power that Captain Falcon has in this game. Like, not the power, he's just so fast. Oh my god. I can't seem to land anything on him. And also, Little Mac makes me just, I hate Little Mac. Little Mac may be my least favorite character to fight of them all. Like, fuck Little Mac, dude. Such a pain in the ass. I get his recovery is like nothing, but god damn, he shits on you early game. Like, he just shits on you. What the hell? I can't deal with that. Go away. Go away, dude. Oh, shit. Is he dead yet? No, he's not dead yet. Got it. Ooh, that was scary. I was very scared, actually, for my life. Woof! Man, regarding the off-topic of the Smash thing, I don't know if you guys saw it yet, but they actually just revealed a new trailer for the next, oh shit. I thought my fireworks would kill him. Crap. What I was gonna say is that they revealed the next trailer for the next zombie map, which is, it's something in Russian that I can't pronounce. Something in Russian, though. I lost- Oh no, I lost my bow! Oh no! It's something in Russian that I can't pronounce. God, the lag every time I go through there is insane. But it's in Stalingrad. And in Stalingrad, it's like Nikolai's- Obviously, it's Nikolai's time because Stalingrad, Nikolai, Russian. Gonna place this right here! These guys are a little bit mean. Alright, so, anyway, yeah, it's in Russia, and there are some interesting things going on this map. I know about you, but I was pretty hyped when I saw- Oh, right, fuck, dude. I was pretty hyped when I saw that trailer. If you haven't seen the trailer, go ahead and look up the, Call of Duty, like, Russia, or Stalingrad map, whatever, I don't know, something like that. Go to the YouTube channel, you can find it. It's a really cool looking map, because it's not only is it in Stalingrad, not only the zombies look pretty edgy, they look really scary, but it also, just looks very impressive, and they have these really weird things in that map. Like, they have weird electric floating things, and they have, like, a really heavy soldier. It kind of reminds me of the Vorkuta guy in Black Ops 1, and they have a dragon. They have a legit dragon. Like, not like a weird dragon, like, in this map, it's just kind of like, oh, it's a dragon, you know, like, on the wall. It's a legit flying, fire-breathing, straight-up dragon. Don't know why, don't know how, don't understand any of this, but it's there, and it looks cool. But, I mean, at the end of the day, it's kind of funny. At the end of the day, the greatest thing that happened in that entire map, the entire story right there, the entire trailer, was Dempsey went to the mystery box and picked up... Where am I going? Oh, so it goes this way. And picked up the PPSH. If you don't know, in World at War, the PPSH, or also known as the Reaper, was known as the Grinder, or the Meat Grinder, whatever you wanted to call it, was probably one of the strongest zombie weapons in zombies ever. You went through ammo a little bit quick, but you had so many bullets and you fired so fast that you just tore through zombies so quickly, and you got a million points because of it. Very well liked gun. Very well liked gun. People had a great time with that thing. And it's so nice to have it back too, because it's just fun. It's just a fun gun. Fun gun. Now, if you have your bass just turned up to max in this game right now, you must be hearing some funny shit. Alright, so we're going back, I suppose. I can see how many zombies I can kill before I have to turn on the teleporter. I love fireworks. I love fireworks. Okay, that's enough. Oof, we've been going pretty far for this map. Haven't gone as far as the Giant, but I'm not really trying to go for a lot of the bows or anything. The Giant's just really easy because you got that catwalk. There's no catwalk on this map. With multiple players on this map, and even in solo, you can actually do pretty damn well. But... Oh. Whoopsie-daisy. Oh well. It was a good run. I had a great time with this map. Felt pretty good. Anyhow, my name is Bricky Yorker today. Thank you so much for watching Fireside Bricky. I hope you have, or I hope you're excited for next week's, which is Zetsubo no Shima. And thank you so much for watching. If you watched all the way till the end, please go ahead and type in all caps, The Iron Dragon. All right. Hope you have a great day. Bye-bye.